Hi, I'm Tamara, and this is TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Hi, everyone. Today, I'm speaking with Jaylene Tyme. We had such a good conversation talking about how to find your truth and who we really are and what that journey's like. Jaylene's journey is really, really interesting, and there's a lot to learn from her. She's an Indigenous trans woman, a very visible member of Vancouver's LGBTQ2+ community, and she has a really important message for parents at the end of our conversation. I hope you enjoy. Hi, Jaylene. How are you?
Good morning to you. I'm doing really well. Thank you for inviting me.
Oh, I'm so happy to have this conversation with you. I really want to talk about you, really, and your story and your work and your advocacy, and because you've had a story. Well, you have a story. You haven't had one. You have one. You're still living your story, and I think it's really remarkable. And I think that, you know, when we share our stories, we help other people without even really knowing it.
Yes, I do. A journey of self-discovery is one where we get to learn things every day. And I think one of the wonderful gifts that I've been able to have is to learn how to live my authentic life with pride, and knowing that every step of the way, everything that I have learned in my journey is of benefit to myself and to others. And I think that the more we're able to tap into the power of our personal truth and realizing that that is the most special place to be, the more that we're going to encourage others to tap into that as well. So I know that when anybody reaches out to me for any questions on my journey, that it's an opportunity for me to really tap into that, but also to acknowledge how sacred our personal stories are. And myself, as an Indigenous two-spirit trans-identifying human being, I realized that my demographic of people haven't always been celebrated or welcomed in this world, and we have to face a lot of adversity and discrimination, systemic racism, and many different challenges that seemingly are in our way. And so I think it's really important to be able to have discussions with people regularly on this journey, and to know that our society, as it evolves within these last two to three years, specifically with the focus on social justice, with systemic racism, with Black Lives Matter, but also with the residential school systems, and how there is a light towards our history, and making sure that we are telling the true story of what that means, and also the effects that has on many generations of our people.
Mm-hmm. So let's start. I mean, we don't have to start right at the beginning, but you were born in Saskatchewan and adopted at a very young age. So what was that like?
Yeah, so I was born in, like you just said, in Saskatchewan in the early 70s. And I know I don't look old enough, but it's true.
but go ahead.
I was part of the Sixties Scoop, which is where Indigenous children were removed from their homes and placed for adoption in settler families. And so that's my experience. I was raised by a lovely family who did the best that they could to raise me as their own. And, you know, so that started off at a young age of being uprooted from my family unit. Probably around the age 3-4 years old is when I was adopted, when I was 4. So from the age of 1 till about, I was in multiple foster care homes, and then I was went to my forever home. And so that, now that I look back at it as an adult, I'm able to really process what it must have been like for that little child to not really have place to connect at that young age, because we can all identify as and a lot of parents that I've talked to can't even imagine their little child being not having those roots and not having that connection. Mm-hmm. So,
or having your child scooped away from you, right? It's I think that, you know, we still have a lot of learning to do around what the 60s scoop was and how it still is happening. As we're seeing in the foster care system with Indigenous children and babies and youth. Were you raised knowing you were Indigenous? Were you raised understanding your roots?
I was raised knowing I was adopted and that I was Indigenous to a point. One of the things that I found really interesting is that my mother shared with me that they were told just to raise me as their own. So they weren't encouraged to connect me to culture or have any education on where I came from. I actually, as a child, took ownership of being Scottish, which was, when we look back at it now, it's like, as a little child, I'm like, oh yeah, my parents are Scottish. So I just sort of grabbed onto that because I just, you know, I think you just want to connect. And so when I look back at it now, that's part of the real sad part of it is that so many children, and fortunately I was in a family that had a real strong moral base. So I was okay. But there's a lot of children that wasn't the case. So, I mean, you know, we talk about these stories and that's why they're really important to really, reconciliation is really powerful for there's all these people that are in this world and they've been able to navigate and find their own and create their own lives. But we have to remember all of the journeys and the challenges that they had to go through. And, you know, I was one of those children. I think that coming into that family as Indigenous in a primarily white community, settler community, I really felt like I stood out. And there was a couple of us, one of my cousins was adopted, and just very few Indigenous people in that community. So I actually felt different from the start. And then add on the spectrum of gender identity, which I couldn't put words to as a child. I just knew that I was different. And being in a society that was a small farming community and hockey was ruled supreme and all these kind of things. So little boys did this and little girls did that. And there was no spectrum of fluctuation with that. It really was like black or white. You know, this is what you did. And I didn't connect to that. So that was really challenging for me. And so what I did pretty quickly was find a place of my own. And that was through my artistry.
Right. Well, and it was, like you said, it was the 70s, right? 70s, 80s. And I don't ever recall hearing as a child in the 70s and 80s about, you know, LGBTQ2+ or anything like that. Nothing. And obviously not the 60s scoop or anything either. So it was a time that, like you said, it was very black or white. Like girls did this and boys did this. And that was it.
Yeah. And I think it's really, when we talk about systemic racism overall, it's not the racism isn't the shark, it's the water. You know, so when we think about the fact that this is all our society knew, I mean, it was set in a binary way, and it was set up pretty good if you were a cis white male or female, and you were set up. Like things were, you know, you could create a life of your own with ease.
Mm-hmm. Well, and yeah, you're totally right, because we were also, I don't know what it was like for you, but for me, you know, always told you're going to get married and you'll have kids and you'll have a house and you'll get a job and you might be a teacher or a nurse, Tamara. That's, you know, and those were my only options, really, right? So you talked about your artistry and how that's you were able to, you know, find yourself or be yourself, or that's where you were comfortable. How? So you weren't a farmer. You didn't. You weren't interested in the farming part of things.
Oh, I think that what I think is really special about myself as I have learned to get to know myself is right at the beginning, I knew what I liked and I knew what I didn't like. And that was a challenge at the time, but now I know that's the strength. I didn't fall into what people were telling me to be and to think and to feel. And I think that, you know, I would think as a parent, I would want my child to be like to be able to take ownership of what they think and to express themselves and to explore and to know what they don't like and not just to have somebody tell you what you like. And so I look back at it now as, yeah, as confusing as it was, you know, I had to find something. So I just created my own world. But now that I look back, I have a really strong, I believe, spiritual connection. And I've been able to really tap into what's important. And what's really important is to feel good and to be really aware of my life through gratitude. And to take a look at, you know, getting up in the morning and looking outside and realizing how blessed I am to be on this earth today. And I know that opens up many other opportunities for connection and clarity in my life. And I believe I've always been tapped into that. But like I said, as a child, I couldn't put words to it. But I knew that when I climbed a tree and I knew when I drew a picture on paper, that there was something special. There's a gift there. And although I didn't connect to anything else that was being taught to me, I had something there that was special. And I would sit in that. And that was real strength. And I look back and I realize that's part of my ancestral energy of being Indigenous. I'm not with my family, but their blood runs through me. And the strength of me being there is really, it, as that child, I was always taken care of. And I can look back now and knowing that even in the most challenging times, and I've had many were life-threatening actually, but I was able to get through by a power greater than myself that guided me to safety. And in turn, to pay attention towards the unknown. But knowing that there's real power in that trust.
So, Jaylene, when you came to Vancouver, you were not Jaylene. You weren't identifying as Jaylene.
Actually, I was, because I first, before I made it to Vancouver, I went to Calgary, and that's where I first met, the gay community, really. It's the first time I went into a space was in Calgary. So I lived there for a while, met some friends that were like-minded, and that was really great, and ran around being a young person exploring and, you know, I fell down, bumped my knees, bumped my head, did a bunch of stuff and got up again, kept getting up again. And we went for a drive to Vancouver and I've been here ever since. So we're going back many years now. But that when I came here, it was literally to the city that never sleeps. And we were in the nightlife here. And like I had mentioned, couch surfing, meeting some people, and my friend ended up going back, but I ended up staying because there was something inside of me that connected to city life that I couldn't explain, but it was in there. It was just waiting for me, I felt.
Mm-hmm. So at what point, and then, I mean, things obviously got dark for you because you started drugs, alcohol, and you had addiction to both. And so I'm assuming that during that period of time, I mean, you and I have been talking like it's, you know, great. And you came to Vancouver and you were Jaylene and everything was right. And the nightlife and all that. But really there was obviously some other things happening that life was not you hadn't realized your full self yet, obviously.
Yeah. You mentioned darkness. And for me, I as a child was welcomed into this world with darkness. So I don't look at that time as being dark because my whole existence was seemingly dark because I didn't know where I fit in and I didn't know anything about pride of self. I didn't know any of that. And everything about me that I was being taught was wrong. So I just reverted to I just didn't know. I was so confused. And so I found the power in my artwork, like I mentioned, and I found the power in connection to nature, to climbing trees and to moments of that I was able to pause on my own in my safe. I create my own safety spaces. And so when I went through, into the city, into the party, I felt such elation because there were people that understood me and it came with the party and the drugs and the alcohol that I didn't know was probably predisposed in me, just waiting to be opened up. And so I went into that, and I didn't know that I couldn't control it. And so it took me into situations because I had no self-esteem and no view of myself, of taking care of myself, because I didn't really have any value to myself because I didn't fit in any. I wasn't taught that. I wasn't taught I was valuable. I was taught that I was, and not intently, but it just, the overall message I got was that there is something wrong with me. And so when I went into this world, I just didn't care about myself. So I made decisions that were pretty fearless when you think about it. And I would enter into relationships as well, because I actually, as soon as I went to the queer space, pretty shortly thereafter, I started to dress up and to do drag and come into the spaces. And then I realized pretty quickly that it was pretty easy for me to be able to transform into the female gender. And with that came the attention from men. The same men that used to bully me were now attracted to me. So I learned pretty quickly through the having grown up identifying as a male up to this point, I kind of knew what they wanted. So I was able to manipulate, and I had to take care of myself. And it was through through drugs and alcohol and through the through sex work. And that's sort of where that led me to that place, to led me to situations that put me in harm's way, and in situations that were being held at gunpoint and also being abused physically and left, you know, I could have been left for dead. And there's, I'm saying this just because, and this is, it's pretty shocking to say, but this is the truth. This is where it led me. And like I mentioned earlier, that I was, I couldn't explain it until now, that there was a power greater than myself that would swoop in, that would guide me back to safety. But in that situation, it was, my life was set up for, and we talk about this, and, March 31st is the day of transgender visibility, and worldwide for me, I feel that my purpose now is to share my story, because we have, internationally lives being lost at the hands of this discrimination. And for me to share my story as a survivor, that I was put into that position, many times, that I could have lost my life, but I did not. So I'm here now to share my story and to share the fact that my life is valuable. And I have found that that value over the years through the people that I met when I was on living on the streets of the downtown east side. We created community together, and we were able to, in the darkest of times, like you mentioned, it wasn't dark to us. This was, we found each other. So all that confusion that we grew up with, We didn't have it anymore, because we knew together that, yeah, this is, the world wasn't set up for us, but we can create our own world, and no matter what we experience, we can get through this together. So that's what I took from that. So the depth and the real hardships that I faced in the moment wasn't hardships for me. It was just my journey. And I was able to learn every step of the way, and fortunately, I was set up with a strong moral base from the parents that raised me. So I knew there was a way out.
Right.
What's really sad is that there are a lot of people that don't know there's a way out, and they don't get out.
Yeah. And I mean, we Jaylene, we hear stories and see stories in the news all the time about the discrimination and the, I mean, I can only describe it as fear, I guess, fear towards transgender people. I don't know. Is that where it comes from? Is that where this violence towards the trans community comes from? Is it come from people's fear?
Well, I think that anytime anybody reacts in that way of another person they don't know, it definitely would be fear. Yeah, I would think. I mean, I don't know how another person could do that to another human being. But in a sense, you know, we talk about when we're in the 70s, and well, you know, that's my experience, that we're actually taught to vilify and homosexuality in itself was considered deviant and was considered something to be, was very shameful. And so a lot of times, you know, I grew up, that was basically how parents would raise their children, was through shame. It's like, and we learned that from a very young age. So if anybody in their mind entertain the thought of a spectrum of sexuality or identity, I mean, it was shut down pretty quickly. So there's a lot of people that repress all that, and they weren't able to explore anything, because if you do, you're in trouble. And we see people coming together in groups of people and ganging up on the vulnerable things that are different. And for whatever reason, that sometimes it's that toxic masculinity. Sometimes it's just it's the strength in numbers of people that are looking at something different. And you know, that's the fearful part of it, is that, you know, this is why these stories are so important to say, is because you have generations of people that now I feel so grateful to be alive to witness how it's opening up for children to be able to be supported by their parents with the proper resources for education on how to guide them in towards their journey with safety, but also safe health practices as well, to help guide them as well. I mean, that's amazing. But that was not available when I was a child. I was actually taken to the doctor for conversion therapy when I was a young child. And not as, and I, my mother also shared with me that, you know, they were actually instructed to do so. So I only went once, but it was very shocking on how people in the professional industry were treating me as a child by shaming me. For example, putting a wig on my head and asking me if I liked that. And giving me these little cards to kind of see if I understood what my family unit looked like with as far as gender went. And as a child, I think I was in grade one. And here's this little child that's just starting, like, going out, meeting children, trying a social dynamic with people taking there and have being told, oh, tell everyone you're going to the doctor, but don't go any further with explaining that. And so all of this is like, I think that, you know, a lot of children, you know, and before me, that could not live in their truth, they had to adjust towards the world because the world was out to kill them.
Mm.
That's reality.
Yeah. And I mean, it's hard to hear because it's just so harsh, and it's hard to understand why we can't accept people for who they are. Like, it just seems like such a simple thing to ask people, like, let, you know, accept everyone for who they are. Like, what was the moment where you went, oh my gosh, I am who I am now? Like, how long did that take you on your road? Or is it something you're still working on?
Yeah, it is something that I'm still working on. And I'm actually really grateful for it. It excites me because I can truly acknowledge moments of true bliss because I'm authentic.
So Jaylene, on our program, we like to give back and we ask our guests to choose a Canadian nonprofit and we give them $500 in your name. You chose the Friends for Life Society and I'm thrilled you chose them. They'll be getting $500 in your name, and Friends for Life Society provides professional health and wellness services to people living in Vancouver with serious life-changing illnesses. So thank you so much for choosing them. So Jaylene, when we look ahead and we know we have work to do, right? And how do people that are, you know, not in the LGBTQ2+ community, how do people help others find their truth or support people or you know, be an ally? How do we do that?
That's a great question. And rather than ally, I always like to, I've heard it be said and I really identified with it, is an accomplice. So it's like it's getting out there and, you know, watching content that is educational and also supporting different, reaching out to see in your communities what are some of the resources that centers that have support for people, whether it be in the spectrum of identity, whether it be sexuality or Indigenous empowerment, women empowerment, all these things. It's like find out what is going on in your community and reach out your hand. And that's a great place to start. You know, one of the things that I love is I happen to work for Blanche McDonald Center, which is one of the places that was like a dream came true for me to be able to go to school to follow my love of the arts and also the real important connection as that my journey has been with that. And Curly Q Beauty is a store in the heart of downtown. And we did a sock drive. So something simple, you know, we asked our friends and some of the shows, I collected some donations and we were able to get, you know, a lot of like, for example, socks. And what we do is we go out and we connect with our street communities and we let them know that, you know, this is just something small, but we want to let you know that we're thinking about you. And, you know, that just the little things that can make a difference. And it can be even, showing up for, you see things online. There's a lot of different shows that have a real focus on different community groups and ticket and showing up is a great place to start.
Yeah, showing up. And before we say goodbye, Jaylene, you know, there's probably a lot of parents listening right now, and maybe their kids are questioning, you know, who they are, and maybe their kids are looking for their truth. There's, you know, we talked about fear earlier. There is a lot of fear. What do you say to parents who just don't know what to do? They don't know what to say. They're scared. They don't know. What would you say to parents?
Oh, I would say to parents, and a lot of times I thank parents, especially when I get to connect with a lot of queer youth. Parents reach out to me and I thank them for encouraging their child to explore freely. That's a big deal. So I think the most important thing I would share with parents is to really celebrate yourself for realizing that you have an opportunity and a responsibility to encourage self-esteem in another human being. That's a big, wonderful thing to acknowledge. And when any parent, if you don't know what to do, you know, just realize that by listening to your children. And yeah, I think the thing about the many challenges that come with being a parent, a lot of parents, you don't know till you have it. Till you have a child, you don't know what to expect. But there are going to be challenges and there's going to be contrast. But I think the thing about it is every single bit of contrast that we experience, we are going to be better for it. And if we can stop and realize that our gift is to provide a safe space, knowing that your unconditional love will do whatever it needs to do to add clarity, to add safety, to add understanding. That is power, and that will make you a different person. And if you can share that message with your child, they're going to be able to face anything in the world and realize that this is life. Life offers us challenge, but also life offers us the ability to take that challenge as a gift of learning something new on how to be of service to ourselves and to the people that come into our lives and to our communities that we're able to be a part of.
I love it. Jaylene, thank you so much for sharing your story and for your time and really for just so many things. There's so many things that I've learned from you in this short amount of time. So I really appreciate it. You are on Twitter and Instagram at Jaylene Tyme. That's JAYLENETYME. Jaylene, thank you so much.
Thank you so much. And remember, the power inside of you is to be you.
Thanks for listening to another episode of TELUS Talks with Tamara Taggart. Be sure to subscribe so you can join us every Tuesday for another conversation. You can also check out our website, telus.com/podcast, and subscribe to our YouTube channel at TELUS Talks.